hate this motherboard. What's the chances of me getting one dead on arrival?
What is up, everyone? My name's Kendall Sinone. As Wiltshire, welcome back to another OptiFlex upgrading video. Now, if you aren't familiar with OptiFlex, OptiFlex is a Dell Optiplex 3040 that I found in the garbage, by the way, and modified it to the gaming PC that you see behind me here. If you haven't seen it, there is a playlist that is going to be linked in the description below, and I highly recommend that you guys check it out before watching this video. With that said, we're going to get into the upgrades that I have for OptiFlex here. Originally, I had this stock Dell OptiFlex 3040 motherboard inside OptiFlex, and now we've upgraded to the 7070 motherboard, which is the one that's right here. And I know you're probably looking at them saying they're the same. They're actually vastly different, these motherboards. They're vastly different. The 3040 motherboard, which is on my left again, this is a motherboard that runs on the Intel H110 chipset, which maxes out with an i7-6700. Now, that's not necessarily a bad CPU. I found that the CPU was bottlenecking the performance of the GPU. So I needed a better CPU. That was the one reason for upgrading. The next was, obviously, you can see that there's two DIMM slots on this as opposed to four over here. So these two DIMM slots are DDR3L. And another thing that's disappointing about this motherboard and its RAM is the 1600 megahertz speed. Now, that's not necessarily slow for DDR3, but it would have been nice if it was 1866 or a little bit higher. There is no M.2 slot, which is very disappointing. And there's also only one X16 slot on this motherboard, which is very limiting for what I can add to the computer. So if we look at the 7070 motherboard, this motherboard runs on the Q370 chipset, which maxes out at an i9-9900. I've got one right there. That is an 8-core, 16-thread CPU that boosts to 4.9 gigahertz when it needs it. So that is an absolute monster of a CPU compared to the 6700 that was originally in OptiFlex. You can use your run-of-the-mill DDR4 in this motherboard here, which is great. The RAM runs at 2666 megahertz as compared to 1600 megahertz for the original 3040 motherboard. So we can use up to 64 gigs of RAM. We can use 16 gigs in each slot here as opposed to 16 gigs overall on the 3040 motherboard. Again, we've only got two slots and it only allowed 8 gigabytes per slot. So it maxed out at 16 gigs. And this can be maxed out at 64 gigs. I only have 32 because I don't think I need 64 gigs. That's a little bit overkill. But another thing that is extremely nice about this motherboard is it's got two M.2 slots right here. So the first one is an M.2 NVMe 2280 in size, and that will definitely save on cable managing. Cable managing is a very difficult thing for OptiFlex. The less cables, the better for OptiFlex, because it's really compact, and trying to stuff a lot of cables in there is difficult. If we look at the second M.2 slot, this is actually for a Wi-Fi and Bluetooth card. And another thing that's great about this motherboard is it's got a second X16 slot for PCIe. Oddly enough, they've chosen to add a PCI slot on this motherboard, even though it's newer than this one. So I don't really know what's going on there. But this motherboard does support serial for some reason. Another thing that was great about this motherboard is it's actually got a USB-C 3.1 jack on it. I don't know what generation this is, to be exact. I don't know if it's Gen 1 or Gen 2. But it's very nice to have USB-C on a motherboard, that's for sure. The thing that sticks out most to me about the 3060 Ti versus the 2070 Super is the fan blade design. Now, if we look at the 2070 Super, you'll notice that there's very thin fan blades with very large gaps in between each fan blade, which points towards these fans kind of being airflow optimized instead of static pressure. Now, if you look at the 3060 Ti fans here, you'll notice that they're very thick and there's very small gaps in between the fan blades, which means this is definitely going to be a lot better in terms of static pressure. So I imagine we're going to get better cooling out of this guy here as we did with the 3060 Ti. The 3060 Ti only has one power connector. Like I said, the less cables in OptiFlex, the better. With the 2070 Super, I had to run two PCIe power cables. We have an 8-pin and a 6-pin. So we flipped them on the back here to their back plates. You'll notice that the gunmetal color is pretty much all the way throughout the 2070 Super. Meanwhile, the 3060 Ti is actually a black backplate, which actually fits the aesthetic more of my build for OptiFlex. And most of it is blacked out in there. So I much like this backplate a lot better. I actually like the design of it a little bit better. It's a little bit more cleaner, a little bit more stealthier. Both cards have 8 gigabytes of RAM in it. This is GDDR6 on both of them, but this one's got DLSS 2.0. So that's another big step up for OptiFlex. Having DLSS 2.0 and the better ray tracing is definitely going to be a nice feature to have. So with the hardware upgrades out of the way, let's get into some gaming benchmarks. That's where we're all here to see. So the first game that we're going to benchmark today is my go-to BR, which is Apex Legends Season 7. Now all the footage that you see in the benchmark footage is going to be 1440p. And it's going to be upscaled to 4K to fit the resolution of this video. And all of the benchmarks will be running in 1440p, as 1440p seems to be the sweet spot for resolution when using a 3060 Ti. And I was actually very surprised to see that the 3060 Ti was only running about 77 degrees. So let's get to the numbers here. At 1440p, medium high settings with AA off and trilinear filtering, we got a maximum FPS of 144.9, which is the in-game engine max for FPS. For Apex Legends, we also got an average FPS of 139.8, a minimum FPS of 98.6, a 1% low of 92.9, and a 0.1% low of 73.5. So it actually ran super smooth. I was very happy with how Apex Legends was running. The average frame rate was actually insanely good. It was buttery smooth. I didn't have any frame time hitching or anything like that. It was very, very good. As you can see, there's a lot of particle effects going on. It was just super smooth overall. So, moving on, the next game up is going to be Doom 2016. I decided against using Doom Eternal because I've used Doom 2016 in the rest of my benchmarking videos and just wanted to use it for consistency. So this is in 1440p using the Ultra preset, using the Vulkan API, TSAA, and motion blur was off as well. The maximum FPS for Doom was 200.9, which is the in-game max FPS. The average FPS was a staggering 199.4, the minimum FPS was 192.3, a 1% low of 139.4, and a 0.1% low of 114.2. So as always, Doom is an insanely optimized game, and it ran really well, and it just squeaked out a victory over the RTX 2070 Super. So let's move on to the next game. Again, to stay with consistency, we'll be using Rise of the Tomb Raider again today for the benchmarks. So let's get into the numbers. We were running on the very high preset with SMAA and motion blur was also off. For the maximum FPS, we got 182, an average FPS of 138.7, a minimum FPS of 89.6, a 1% low of 85.2, and a 0.1% low of 65.2. So with those numbers from the 3060 Ti for Rise of the Tomb Raider, I was actually pleasantly surprised. It's a very graphically intense game, so I think it did pretty well. The last game that we'll be using to benchmark is going to be The Witcher 3, and it's pretty insane on how old The Witcher 3 is, and it still pushes hardware to its limits. So moving on to the numbers, we were on the Ultra preset using SMAA and motion blur was also off. Got a maximum FPS of 98.1, an average FPS of 85.8, a minimum FPS of 75.7, a 1% low of 72.8, a 0.1% low of 69.2. So those were the gaming benchmarks of OptiFlex here. I hope you guys enjoyed those. Let me know what you think of those in the description below. Next, we're going to get on to the synthetic benchmarks. Now, I have FireStrike open here. We're going to start with FireStrike. I want to give a little bit of a disclaimer though before I get into anything else, is I did disable the Meltdown and Spectre patches using Inspector, which is a small program that will disable those patches. By doing so, you'll actually boost the performance of your Intel CPU because Intel actually had to slow them down to patch those CPUs properly. So with that said, let's get into FireStrike. So FireStrike was actually pretty good, and I scored 22,599 on FireStrike, which is about 100 points shy of the average, unfortunately. OptiFlex is probably a little bit of a hotbox and things probably getting a little warm in there, so that's probably why our score is about 100 points shy of the average on this run here. So if we compare that to the old version of OptiFlex, which is again with the 6700 and 2070 Super, FireStrike score was 17,983. So that is a massive jump in terms of performance for OptiFlex by just upgrading to the 9900 and the 3060 Ti. So that is a massive jump for the FireStrike score. If we compare our graphics score inside both of those, our graphics score for the new and improved version of OptiFlex was 27,648. Meanwhile, on the old version of OptiFlex, our graphics score was 25,585. So we got about a 2,000 point jump from the 2070 Super to the 3060 Ti, which I think is actually really good. I'm actually very happy with those results. And moving on to the physics score. So we look at the physics score for new and improved OptiFlex. It is 21,713. Now, if you are familiar with old OptiFlex, which had an i7-6700, remind you, It is absolutely no contest in terms of the physics score. The physics score on old OptiFlex was 11,468. So we got a 10,000 point jump from the 6700 to the 9900, which is absolutely insane. That's a huge result. I'm very happy with that. That's amazing. So we compare the combined results or the scores for the new and improved OptiFlex. It got 9,790. Meanwhile, the old version of OptiFlex got 7,568. So those are the FireStrike benchmarks there. I'm actually very pleased with the results from OptiFlex here, the new improved OptiFlex. Next, we're going to move on to Cinebench R23. So in Cinebench R23, I got a multi-core score of 9,468 on the 9900, which was just above a 9880H. So that's about right for the 9900. As for the single-core score, I actually ran this once before, and my first run was 11,065, and I was really puzzled by that because that is actually below the 9880H. But I ran it again for a second time today, and I scored 1,254, which is actually above the 9880H by quite a bit, about 100 points actually. So I don't know what happened there, but those are the scores for Cinebench R23. And in the old version of OptiFlex, I had this AliExpress M.2 adapter for an X1 PCIe slot, and that's what I used for additional storage. Now with the actual M.2 port on the 7070MT motherboard, I've benchmarked the exact same SSD that I used in the previous test, and if we bring that up here, it is actually just a blowout. Having the actual M.2 port on the motherboard instead of that X1 adapter, obviously the X1 adapter is going to bottleneck it, but I didn't realize how much it was actually bottlenecking the performance of this thing. If you look at my results here, I got a 3100 read speed and almost a 3000 write speed on the exact same drive. That is insane compared to the AliExpress adapter that I had. So those are the benchmarks for that M.2 adapter. And I'm just going to quickly show you guys my FireStorm overclocking settings, and then that is going to conclude the video. So I only unfortunately could get 110 megahertz out of the GPU core, or else it would start crashing. Don't know why. I don't know if I won the silicon lottery or not. I probably lost it knowing my luck. So let me know if you got the same card as I do, what kind of overclocking you got on your card. I would very much like to know. As for the memory clock, I was able to push 500 megahertz on the memory clock there. And that is going to wrap up the new and improved OptiFlex. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I very much liked upgrading this video, but the old motherboard that I had, which I don't have on me right now, the one that I showed in the intro, that actually died. I actually built this computer, tried to film it. I even cut the rear I/O. I had to cut it because of the different layout for the motherboard ports on the back. It died on the first boot up, and I don't know what happened. Luckily, the RAM was okay, the CPU was okay, the GPU was okay. The motherboard just coughed, and I don't know why that happened. I'm using the same adapter, same PSU. Luckily, that didn't blow either. But that original motherboard died on me, so I had to wait another 2 weeks for another motherboard to come in, which is unfortunate. But we got her running with the second motherboard, so I'm very pleased with that. And I apologize for the delay for this video because I had to wait for parts. And it's a pandemic, and postal services aren't running as fast as they normally would. Anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Let me know in the comments section below if you guys want to see any more content from me or things like OptiFlex in the future. Hit that subscribe button and that like button. I'd very much appreciate that. As always, I will always see you guys in the next video. See you later, guys.
How could I forget putting this on? Let's just get that i5 one off of there. There we go. Time to slap the i9 on there. I'll get at least 10 more FPS now. There we are.